All right, good morning. Good morning, colleagues, graduate students, visitors. I'm Dr. William King. I'm chair of the Beto committee for about one more week. The Beto chair and the Beto chair lecture series was established in 1979 as an endowed chair in honor of walking Dr. George J. Beto. It has enriched the College of Criminal Justice since 1981, and this lecture series is made possible by that endowment, where we bring an esteemed researcher to visit, lecture, meet with graduate students, and see how awesome we are, and so that we can share in how awesome they are. The series began when John Conrad was the first Beto endowed lecturer in 1981. Since that time, it's a list of who's who, including Jerome Skolnick, 1984, Herman Goldstein in 1989, David Farrington in 1993, Mita Chesney Lind in 2007, Sam Walker, Joanne Belknap, and on and on and on. So it is my pleasure, I'm delighted, I'm tickled I am, to introduce to you Dr. and Professor Beth Huebner. Dr. Huebner is a professor in the Department of Criminology and Criminal Justice at the University of Missouri at St. Louis, where she has been for 15 years. She earned her PhD in criminal justice from Michigan State University in 2003. Her research interests are collateral consequences of incarceration, racial and gender disparities in criminal justice processing, and she is very active in research and practitioner researcher partnerships and turning her research into actionable policy and practice for agencies, something that is near and dear to the very core of the center and the college. And so she is the principal investigator on the St. Louis County MacArthur Safety and Justice Challenge, which is a jail population reduction initiative. And she is also part of the Misdemeanor Justice Project. That's my cue to stop talking. However, I must point out that Dr. Huebner is a very accomplished distance athlete, and she's an Ironman and completed the Ironman in Wisconsin. So with that, I turn it over to you, Dr. Huebner. Thank you very much for being here.
Yeah, thank you. Does that work? Great. I accomplished my first task. So thank you for being here. Bill took a little bit of my introduction, but I will. It's just such an honor to be here and to share the stage with such greats. And as you mentioned, Joanne Belknap, Jim Lynch, who I know very well, Scott Decker, my former colleague, Joan Petersilia, who is basically my idol in terms of corrections, and then my colleague Rick Rosenfeld. So it's just so great to be here. I thought I would tell you a little bit how I got to corrections. I feel like you are my people. I feel like I'm here with a bunch of corrections geeks. So I wanted to tell you a little bit how my pathway began, which was in 1992. So you can do the math. I was in high school and the debate team was mass incarceration. And that's really how I got sucked into this topic, if you can believe it, as a young high school student. I was just blown away that we would send people to these institutions and leave them there. So I loved Foucault before I even knew who he was, right? So I've just been a nerd forever. And then when I went to the University of Wisconsin-Madison, I was able to do a special project in the Dane County Jail, which was the jail in St. Louis was actually modeled after the Dane County Jail. And now every Thursday, I go to the St. Louis County Jail. And so I feel like my career has completely gone in a circle. And so I'm so excited to be back in jail. So again, I know you guys all feel me. My eyesight's not that great, so I'm going to have to come back and forth and read some of the quotes. But I usually do a lot of quantitative research, but I've been really excited to learn about the stories of the people that have been in the criminal justice system over the last couple of years. So I'm going to share some of that information. As I mentioned, I'm a nerd. I also love to take pictures. And so you'll see pictures here from, it's the Walls Prison in Jefferson City. It's now shut down and it's a museum, so you should come and visit me and I will take you on the tour. And also, about a month ago, I was in Harris County, and you guys have a new processing center in Harris County. It's fantastic. And again, if you know me, you know how excited they let me come in and take my camera. So I have pictures from inside that new facility, and no one's, I think people live there now, but they didn't when I was there last month. So I was telling a bunch of people at breakfast, Ferguson is right down the street from my office. I can literally walk to Ferguson. One of the gas stations that were burned down is my gas station. So all of our faculty have been deeply affected by the events in Ferguson. And we know, as part of the Ferguson report, how many challenges there were in terms of legal and financial obligations. And so fines and fees, misdemeanor tickets, all of these things are what I'm going to talk about today. Most of my research is, like I said, on mass incarceration, why people are in prison for a long time. But I've shifted more to looking at the small mark that a misdemeanor arrest or small contact with the criminal justice system and how that affects you long term. Because that affects most of us, right? Who has an outstanding parking ticket? I do. I think it's funny. I go do all this research and then I get more tickets. I got to figure that out. Okay, so we also know that we're not supposed to go to jail or prison for unpaid tickets, right? That is what Bearden versus Georges meant, right? You must evaluate the ability to pay and also determine willful non-payment before you can jail somebody or put them in prison for not paying legal and financial obligations. And that's an important rule, but I'm going to show different ways in which you can get kind of stuck up into the jail or prison system without violating Bearden, and there's a number of different ways. And we also know that these fines and fees widen the net and really strengthen the ties, suck people deeper and deeper into the criminal justice system. So that's what I'm going to talk about today. What do I mean when I talk about legal financial obligations? So there's a lot of different things, and this is why it's so exciting in some ways. So in Missouri, you have to pay if you're in jail. I'll talk about that in a little bit. Also, if you are, and that's pretrial, I will also talk about a little bit, if you've been in prison and you have the means to pay, they can also charge you for being in prison. There's a public defender fee. I don't know about you guys, but until I started this project like 3 or 4 years ago, I naively thought that public defenders were free. Again, you can be in the criminal justice system for a long time and continue to learn things. If you get your license taken away, there's a fee to get it reinstated. In Missouri, we have a lot of probation and parole fees. We also have a lot of private probation in Missouri. That's something that makes us unique as well. And then there's a lot of surcharges to use your credit card to pay things. Again, I'm sure a lot of you have had this experience. So this is from CNN. So it's a very basic slide that I took from them, but it just kind of shows what I'm talking about. When we talk about the crisis in Ferguson and what people were being involved in the criminal justice, what sort of offenses they were for, you can see that they're what we would consider pretty minor. Again, things that perhaps you didn't do yourselves, right? So kind of put yourselves in these shoes that you didn't, you know, you didn't have car insurance, maybe you couldn't pay for your car insurance. You have speeding, things like that. And I didn't bring any statistics on Missouri or St. Louis, but St. Louis has some of the deepest pockets of poverty as any other city in the US. We have very deep and isolated populations, particularly in our north side of our city. So poverty is something that we really struggle with in Missouri, as many places. So I just want to talk about theory for just a second. I'm not going to go a ton into theory, but we can talk about that if you have questions or if the students want to discuss it as well. Obviously, we're talking about this social control framework, right? So mass incarceration has taken over a large part of the U.S. It's something that's unique to my generation. I feel like I was born, and maybe it's me. Incarceration shot up right after I was born. And so that's been a fact of my whole life, but it's not a fact of my parents' lives. And so, you know, we are now in a really unique era. And there's so much research, really great research out there on the collateral consequences of incarceration, not only for the individual, but the community and the family. I'll touch a little bit on all of that today as well. As I mentioned, my friend Foucault, I think this is really an interesting way to think about fines and fees in that, you know, Foucault talks about, you know, we're no longer in the gallows, right? We're not putting you in the public square anymore. But it's more subtle than that. And it can actually be more intrusive in that fines and fees can take over your whole life. And so you're like, it's just a ticket. I go to meetings all the time. They're like, Beth, it's just a ticket. We all get them. It's not a big deal. But that's why, once we say it's not a big deal, and we see how these cumulative effects add up, that you can just see how it expands the carceral state to so many people that were never involved before. And with our openness of mugshots and criminal records, your marking is deeper and more sticky, as Chris Eugen calls it, than ever before. So I also want to talk about the process as punishment. I could do a whole talk on this as well. And again, I can talk about this in lunch over questions. But we also, the process as punishment. We've done, I'll talk a little bit about this, court interviews. But the way that people are expected to go through the system, the way they're supposed to act, what language they're supposed to use, that is an extra punishment. And so I'll talk about that on the next slide. So if you haven't read Kohler Hausman's work, she's got a book out as well as a great article about misdemeanor justice and how it brings people more into the system. And so she talks about three elements. The first one is marking. So again, this is really, really important. We are in a digital age. We are a big data age. We are, and I'm going to actually argue for more data at the end. So it's a double-edged sword. We know more things about people than you ever want to know, right? Everybody Googles people. I'm sure maybe you Googled me before I came here. So there are so much information about your criminal history, what you're like, how many pictures you took on Facebook, things like that. So what would have been not a big deal before is more of a deeper mark. We also, she talks about procedural hassle. And this seems like something that we see a lot, or it is something that we see a lot in Ferguson, as well as misdemeanor and courts across the nation. But there's opportunity costs, which I'll talk a lot about, of compliance with the law, right? So for me, I've got a great job, I've got a great car, I have a fantastic partner, and parents and kids and stuff like that. So if I have to pay my parking ticket, or I paid it late, which I did, I can pay the late fee. It's not a big deal. But I don't have to go to court, or if I did have to go to court, I could take the day off. I'm sure my boss wouldn't care, and it wouldn't be a big deal. And I could park, and it would be no big deal. I have gas. I don't have to take the 2-hour public transportation. But what we see is for very small things, the hurdles are just enormous. I'm teaching a community corrections course right now, and I make them try to figure out how to get their driver's license back after they've lost it because they couldn't pay for insurance or something like that. It's not easy. It's pretty much a hassle. So again, for things that I could have somebody to do, I could have somebody take care of that for me, my attorney take care of me, that's just an extra punishment. And we'll see how this affects people's lives. Again, this doesn't seem like a big deal. You're like, oh, it's a hassle, but you take care of it. But how these add up over and over again. What I also think is we expect people to do a performance, right? We expect you to be responsible. We expect you to act in a certain way in the courtroom. Mostly defined by white people of privilege, right? So, for example, in Missouri, you can't wear spaghetti straps or flip-flops to court. But you don't know that until you get to court, right? How would you know that? I mean, you guys live in Texas, same as Missouri, similar. It's hot. Who isn't wearing flip-flops in the summer, right? So it's this hassle, like you're supposed to know how to perform, but no one tells you what the rules are. At least I don't know them. Right? You have to wait in a normative way. I see kids in the courtroom all the time. You're not supposed to have kids in a lot of our courtrooms. What are you supposed to do with your kids? Right? Even simple things. When we've done court observations, court takes 4 hours. The meter only goes 2 hours. What am I supposed to do? Again, so then I get a ticket. And again, I've gotten tickets. It's a problem. So, and one thing I hear from court actors all the time, which makes me want to poke myself in the eye, is that people need to have skin in the game. They need to pay a little money so they'll learn, so they'll know. Okay. You know, so these are things that we have to think about in terms of theory. So I want to move on to the study so I can talk to you about some of the findings. I'm going to talk about one more thing, I apologize. Some of the research. So I'm working with Alexis Harris. She has a great book called Pound of Flesh, and this is something that she talks about a lot. But what she argues is that legal financial obligations, they reinforce poverty. So most of the people I'm going to talk about today were already in deep poverty, mostly generational poverty, and this just continues to destabilize reentry. And it really leads to a lifetime of punishment. It's this very thick, deep web that people get stuck in, and that only exacerbates inequality over time. What we also know from her work, as well as others, is that it's not cost-effective. And I try to tell people, I go to meetings all the time, I'm like, you know you're just spent $100 to keep that person in jail, right? But do you know you're not gonna get any money back from that individual? So they know, we know that we spend a lot more money than we get back. So that's something that we're gonna have to think about as we look at policy. Harris and Beckett have looked at variations by state, and then my awesome former student, Brianne Plagenkuhl, did some great work on Missouri. So we see these patterns in other states as well. So if you have a chance to look at those, I would. So what's my current study? Again, this is from the, it's right by the phone area in your Harris County area, so I thought it was fantastic. So what's this current study? Again, this is just for the students here. This is always a good idea. I'm sure people are gonna tell you that you have to say no to things and, you know, everything like that. I never say no. Just ask me something, I'll be like, I'll do it. But one day I'm just working at my office and Alexis Harris calls me and she's like, I wanna put in this grant. It's gonna be like $5 million to Arnold. And this is 5 years ago when Arnold, I mean, everybody knows Arnold is now, but no one knew who Arnold was then. They were just getting into this work. Do you wanna work on this? I was like, sure. And that next week, the MacArthur Foundation called too, and I was like, sure. I was like, no way in heck am I gonna get both of these grants. But in fact, I did, so that was really great. But so these are some of the really great, you know, things that happened just by, you know, students going around and meeting people. I happened to meet Alexis at a meeting. I thought she was great. I kind of told her about my work. And so I've just been able to be part of such a slacker team, as you can see from all of the people I get to work with, just the best of the best in all of these states. So it's been really fun. It's been a learning experience too. And again, I can talk to students about that about, you know, having so many different people in these large scale projects and how you manage them, but it's gone well. So the first year was a legal review. We reviewed in every state everything you could be fined for. And I'll tell you, in California, you can be fined for everything. And then we've done qualitative research. So that's what I'm gonna talk about, the interviews I've done with citizens as well as stakeholders. So that's been really fun to talk about the people who are fined and then the people that do the fining, for lack of a better word. And then my wonderful students have spent 400 hours in courts observing, taking notes. So that's been fantastic. And we also have official data. We don't have a ton for Missouri for a lot of reasons, which I can talk about. But so we are almost done with the 4 years. And then when you write a grant, Alexis was brilliant. She wrote the last year just to write articles. So that's gonna be exciting. So this is, I should say, this is work I've not presented to anybody. This is brand new for you guys. This has been really fun for me to sit in my office the last couple of weeks and really just think. And think about what we're gonna do with all these data now that we have it all. And again, if you know me, I was super excited to go in the sheriff's bus. So I had to take a picture. So I'm gonna just give you a little legal analysis background, and then I'll talk about some of the individual narratives that we have. So what do we know about legal and financial obligations? Some of this stuff seems obvious. My kids are always like, duh, and I tell them what I'm doing at work, right? But we know that legal and financial obligations are routinely imposed. So this is something that affects almost all of us. And we know that they're at the misdemeanor and felony level. But what I'm gonna talk about today is that financial obligations are important, not just because you have to pay money, but because they trigger additional sanctions. So that's what I'm gonna talk about for the whole time. And we see them accumulate over and over and over again. I'm doing a paper now, it's called like Piling On, about how much sex offenders have to pay in terms of fines and fees. So I don't know if you can read this. It's a lot of words. But I just wanted to show you, I'll kind of point over here, some of the different things you can get a fine and fee for. And some of them make sense, right? And this is where a lot of the legal work, there's a lot of great legal work that's being done here. So of course, you know, you probably have to pay for the court automation fund. That's fine, but you also have to pay for the spinal cord injury fund surcharge, right? So maybe you're, again, you just had a parking, or not a parking ticket, but you had a misdemeanor or something, but you do have to pay for those injury funds. You pay for the sheriff as well as a lot of retirement funds as well. So it's not just one finer fee or one small thing. It adds up. So you can see all of these, and this isn't even all of them, but if you have a felony, all of these come with your conviction of a felony. So there's a lot of different ways that you can be, that those can add up. So I actually have statistics from Texas. So we wanted to know, what if you got driving with a suspended license? I feel like, I can't even remember what percentage. I think it's about 30 or 40% of drivers in the St. Louis region are driving with a suspended license. This is a huge, huge, huge problem in St. Louis for a lot of reasons. But how much would it, you know, what would it cost in different states? Again, punishment is not equal across each state. And I can tell you maybe where you don't want to get in trouble. You do want to go and hang out in Minnesota and get in trouble if you're going to get in trouble, right? You're going to get probation and you're going to have a lower fine. It's, you know, not a problem. So their fine is $200. They have some fees. But overall, it would take you about 6 months. If you paid $50 a month, it would take you about 6 months to pay that off. That's compared to Missouri, which is about 5 to 12 months. What can hit you a little bit harder is those incarceration costs. Don't drive with a suspended license in a rural area. I'm going to tell you that now, because they're going to charge you $30 to $60 a day pretrial. So I'll talk a little bit about that. So that can really add that up. You guys are similar to us in Texas, or then in Missouri. There's a few more costs, but it's pretty similar. What we see in California is astronomical, right? And we know there's a lot of people in California with money. Great. But there's a lot of people in California without money. So if you look it up there, it's going to take you 27 to 84 months to pay off your fine and fee. So when we talk about equal justice and things like that, very, 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 very big differences. And again, you know, just their surcharges alone are pretty, pretty overwhelming. Okay, so here's my qualitative interviews. Again, this is your awesome reception center. Very fun. So what did I do? And again, I'll thank my students at the end. I'm really interested in not only the city. I do almost all of my work in the city, but I've been finishing up a number of projects on rural areas, and that's really where we know that the jail population is growing. So I'm very fascinated. So we went to Sedalia, and that is the western part of Missouri. They have a chicken plant. That's about it. It's very rural and extremely poor. It has lower, or it has higher levels of poverty than the inner St. Louis city, so it's very white rural poverty. Cape Girardeau, which is in the Boot Heel near southern Illinois, I'm fascinated by that area because we have some of the largest pockets of rural African American poverty in that area as well. So that's why I did the research there, and each state picked a rural area and an urban area as well. And so we interviewed about, 96 interviews over about that year. And so most of the people came through probation and parole. I have a lot of friends in probation and parole. We were able to recruit people that way. But we also put ads in Facebook, Craigslist, flyers in courts. So we have a large group of different people, and they were paid $20, and it's about an hour interview. So what we know is that costs are very prevalent, but they vary a lot. And so I can read some of these if you can't see them. You know, when I would sit down with people, just like this gentleman, you know, you got to do the numbers, right? I've got this much in child support. I'm not going to talk about child support today, but we definitely could, because that's a big thing. You got child support. He's got 7 or 8 bench warrants, something I'm going to talk about. If you fail to appear in court, you get a bench warrant. So he's got 7 or 8 of those. That's about $150. That's like a grand. So you just have people count it off, and it would go pretty high. So this person had about $9,000 in restitution, victims fund, private attorney was a lot, intervention fees. So all of these things add up. It's very varied, but everyone has some costs. And what we know is when we ask people, like, how much do you owe, they would list it off. But then they would come back and be like, oh, wait, I owe for this, or I owe for this. There's no way to look up how much you owe. Okay, I'll talk a little bit about this. There's like 90 municipalities in St. Louis County. And so you'd have to look them up individually if you wanted to figure out where all your parking tickets or speeding tickets were and things like that. They had no idea what they owe. They had no idea how to find it. And they had no idea how to make a plan. So if I'd be like, hey, you owe $7,000, what's your plan to pay this off? People had no idea, nowhere to get help with that either. You know, this person just came out of prison, actually, and they gave him a sheet of paper, and they said, this is how much you owe. He was just like, how all of a sudden did I get this much money? You know, people make that in a year. So he was just going to deal with it. I mean, you hear a lot of this, like, I have no idea where to start, right? And so maybe some of you can appreciate this if you have student loans. I know it's very different. But we hear about the student loan crisis. You're like, holy crap, what am I going to do? Like, how am I going to pay that off? So it's a similar issue. This is so stressful. How many people get stressed about money? Right. Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, I was like sweating it, doing my tax returns, hoping that I didn't have to pay the government all this money. And again, I'm very, very well off. I have everything I could need. But when you're at poverty, people are very entrenched poverty, this is so stressful. So we know that this is a strain. When you're trying to reenter and do well, this is a huge, huge strain. Like this person, I remember this woman, she was just such a worrywart. It was just so much burden on her. So many people were crying and very upset. She had her daughter, but that was the only thing she could hope for. She just didn't see a bright future for herself. It was just so overwhelming how to get out of this debt. People talked about worrying about what if they died? How would people bury them? They have to pay off these debts. It was just very difficult. This person just got out of jail with $22,000. This is one of the people from a rural area with those jail costs. So how is he going to pay that? And so much anxiety, right? No one likes being in debt, he says. It's pretty disturbing. The last person was like, yeah, I worry, but a lot of people just give up, right? You know, yeah, I won't talk about hospital bills, but they have hospital bills, things like that. People are like, I got them all. This is how much I have, but I can't do anything. So this is what I've been just trying to think about. So I'm not very good at graphics, so if anyone wants to help me with this. I was thinking, I love pathways, as I'm sure lots of you do. So how does a small contact with the criminal justice system, like how does this lead to jail? How does this lead to prison? You're probably like, Beth, it really can't. But I'm going to show you a little bit how it does. So I'm going to talk about how legal financial obligations affect you pretrial. I'm going to talk about how they affect you in prison. Then I'm going to talk about how they affect you on probation. And again, I'm just going to touch on each of these. These, hopefully, each will be paper or something. But I wanted to kind of show how this entanglement works. So let me start. One of the topics that I'm going to talk a lot about is opportunity constraint. This is a theme that comes out just in almost every interview. Either people would be like, I don't know how I'm going to pay, I'm just not going to, or people have to make choices. I'm sure you've all been in that situation before. You know, I'd really like to do this, but I have to choose this. So, you know, your bills come around. You have to make a choice. You have to pay rent. You have to pay water. There's kids. Lots of people have kids. And then I got to go see my probation and parole officer tomorrow, and I'm going to owe them money. So what am I going to do, right? And this is a theme that I think the last sentence is so important. Man sometimes just be wanting to go on the dam run, right? A lot of my work in jail talks about people who violate their probation. Most people are not going and doing big crimes when they violate probation. They are scared and they are running. And they don't know what to do, so they don't show up. They just don't show up to their probation and parole officer. This is huge. I mean, this is like 40% of our jail, I would say. So you see that theme come up here, like, I just don't know what to do. Like, I don't have any money for you. What am I going to do? And I'll talk about ways. They do try to help clients on probation, but people aren't trustworthy of the system, and they don't always know really what that means or what help they can get. So as I mentioned, one of the things, if you read the Ferguson report, and if you haven't had a chance, and you have a second, I know all of these reports are very long. I was just rereading them for a paper I finished last week, just how compelling some of these narratives are and everything that was happening. But there are like 90-ish municipalities. There's a reduction in municipalities post-Ferguson. But when I go to work, some of you guys all have to come visit. I think I drive through, I'm gonna really count one of these days, I drive through about 7 municipalities on my way to work. That means there's like 7 different opportunities for me to get a ticket. And many of these people have 7 different tickets. I think I'm gonna make this the title of a paper, I think is, I've done a world tour before. Some people call it the municipal court shuffle. Lots of words for it, right? So this person, there's a lot of municipalities. He had to go to 7 places one time. If you have a warrant in Missouri, it is required that the police take you to jail. They cannot be like, dude, go pay your warrant, go take care of that. No, they have to take you by law in Missouri to jail. And once you're in jail, then they look you up, and then they literally spend a lot of resources driving you from jail to jail to jail to jail to jail. So this person went to 7 places. He really wanted to cry. He didn't know what to do, right? He never realized what this freedom meant to him until that happened. So that's one of the things that we see, is that if you have 7 tickets, that can really add up and take you away from the community. As I mentioned, it's about $30 to $65 per night in jail, particularly in rural counties. And they can charge you this pre-trial, right? You're all very seasoned criminal justice people. You're innocent before proven guilty, right? But if you can't pay bail or someone can't help you out, then you're going to stay there and then you're going to pay more money. But wait, you couldn't get out in the first place. Again, people are staying in jail. I see this a lot. Luckily, we're working on this with a lot of our reforms. People in jail for $500 all the time, right? All the time. And so if I could pay the $500, then I wouldn't have to pay the $30 or $60. So what that means is you stay in jail for a long time. And so we know from research that just 3 days in jail can make a huge effect on your life, right? So you no longer, they just passed this the other day, you can no longer be jailed for failure to pay board fees. So up until, actually it's not even in effect yet, I think it's like in 2 months or something. If you were in jail, they held you pretrial, and then you couldn't pay it, the sheriff could come and get you after a certain amount of time and send you back to jail for not paying the board fees. So again, this cycle of poverty, you kind of see how that's working. So you're gonna spend a lot more time in jail if you don't have money on a municipal charge. Again, these are municipal charges. This is speeding, not registering your car, things like that. You're not a harm to the community for most of these people. So what are some of the challenges, right? And so one of the biggest issues that I see is lack of communication between jails. So I'm in the Harris County Jail, but I don't know another jail in Texas, so the Austin Jail wants me. And I'm supposed to go to Austin for a hearing, but I'm in the Harris County Jail. Okay, well, Austin just thinks I didn't show up, so I'm gonna get a failure to appear warrant. But no, I was actually incarcerated, right? So they don't talk to each other. And again, when you have that many municipalities in the county, and then we have St. Louis City, and then we have Illinois, I mean, that's a lot of people not talking. Right, so this person was, I'm missing court because I was getting locked up in Maplewood and St. Charles. When I had court for Maplewood, I'm getting locked up by St. Charles because I was in Maplewood. Whew, right? I'm missing court because I'm locked up for one another. This is huge, right? So again, this failure to appear is such a big issue. You wouldn't, again, when I first started this, I thought it would be a big deal, but this is a huge, huge part. People are just cycling through and getting stuck, essentially. We do know that one of the reasons that we don't want people pretrial, if we don't have to, is it leads to guilty pleas. I remember this person very well, and they were in the workhouse in St. Louis City, which does not have air conditioning in the summer. So it's been covered widely by the Post-Dispatch if you want to look that up. But I can't imagine doing time there. It would just be swelteringly hot. It's bad. They talk to you bad. They talk to you like you're nothing, right? I just want to get out of this place, so I plead guilty, right? Is that justice? Even though I messed up my record up, and I know how bad I wanted to get out of that place, so I did it, right? We see a lot of this, and we're working really hard with these reforms to educate people on, if you admit that this is what you did and you take a guilty plea, this record will follow you. That's really, really important. And sometimes people know that and sometimes people don't. But that's why pretrial detention is just a critical issue. And you guys are doing a lot of great work in Harris County, so that's good. Okay, so how do fines and fees affect how I do time? This, I just, I'm a nerd. This just geeked me out. It's horrible how fascinating I thought this was. So if, so I'm in prison and I owe money for a fine or fee or probation expenses. Once you get a probation expense, that's never gonna leave you. Anytime you go to the Department of Corrections, that's gonna be on your record, it's gonna stick with you. If your mom or aunt, it's usually women, which I'll talk about at the end, almost always women, send you money in prison, then the prison gets it. You do not get that money, right? So this narrative is perfect. If your family's gonna put money on there, it's like $150 or $300 immediately, but you know, you're gonna get that pay. It's kind of like a ransom is what he thought, right? And so you get indigent packs. I thought these were fascinating, right? So you get $5 to get shampoo, envelopes, conditioner. Everybody I interviewed said that the indigent packs did not last a full month, right? So when we talk about our good friend Gresham Sykes, right, about the pains of imprisonment, prison is really difficult anyway. And this deepens the pains of imprisonment, of poverty, right? So now you also have a tiered system in prison as well. So people who have fines and fees can't get that money and then have to live off the indigent packs. But what I think is fascinating is, as we know, people are very innovative in prison. I'm sure lots of you have read all these great books. So people try to raise money. So people are gonna make it work, or people are gonna get money. And so this is kind of difficult to explain, but you can read it. So when you owe, you can't. If someone tried to put some money on your books, you're gonna take it. You know, you help people out. But what happens is, like, this person's gonna put money on your books, she's gonna put $50 on there, and I'm gonna give you some money of it. So I'm gonna call Bill Wells's wife and tell her that I need money, and then so Bill's gonna give me some money in prison, but he's gonna take some money off the top, right? So it's just this innovation types of thing. When you owe, you know, you'll take it as soon as you get it. You can do whatever you can to get the money. Why is this a problem? This a problem? Nobody? Okay. I mean, this is a misconduct violation, right? This is scamming. Who do you owe when you get out? What if I owe Bill Wells money when I get out? Crap, right? So what happens? So this is misconduct in prison. What happens when we get misconduct in prison? Do we get good time? No. How well are we doing when we get out? What are all the research? I do tons of stats models. People who have misconduct in prison are not doing as well when they get outside, right? You're just in this game. Right, if we're supposed to be like rehabilitating you and you're playing the same games you're outside, inside, this is kind of a problem. Not to say that people wouldn't be doing that anyway, but we had a lot of people who braided hair, eyebrows, things like that, doing stamps. You know, again, this is something that we see in the prison economy, but we do enhance it, perhaps, it's hard to tell, by these fines and fees. So this is where a small part comes in. So I just thought that was fascinating that you don't get that money. But we see people really struggle with just basic hygiene in prison when this happens. And this list, I don't have any quotes up here, but just this idea of fairness. Like, the punishment is supposed to be prison, right? Prison is supposed to be the punishment. We're not supposed to punish them extra. You don't get plus. But as you guys all know, we do. Okay, so my last theme is the supervision fees. So either I'm on probation or I just came out on parole. How do fines and fees affect me then? Right, so we know that people who are unable to pay their fines and fees actually get extended punishment, and this happens in a lot of ways. So a couple years ago, Missouri did the Justice Reinvestment Act. So one of the ways that we reduced the prison population, although we're still eighth in the nation and growing, but one of the ways that they tried to reduce their supervision population is you can earn compliance credit. So you get 50% off your time for every month that you're good. So if you're good a month, you follow the rules, then you get a month free, essentially. However, you have to pay all your fines, fees, and restitution. Okay? So you owe $30 every month. If you don't pay that $30 that month, you don't get that month. Right. If you have restitution, some people have a lot. I learned a lot. Some people have a lot of restitution. So if you do if you burn down a building or, you know, damage property, a lot of judges are going to pay you, are going to charge you restitution for every single cent. So that means that people with fines and fees are often doing twice the amount of time on probation or parole than people who do not. And we know from the great Joan Peterson, who has been here before, the more you watch people, the more chances you have to find them do something little. The more they're going to want to run, right? People just, who wants to be watched, right? Who wants to check in with somebody every day? So we actually, you know, again, widen and deepen the net that way. Obviously, we've talked a lot about democracy with Chris Eugen on our team about voting. He's done some of the seminal work in this area. So again, if you can earn half your time back. So I'm on probation parole for 4 years. I really want to get off on two. If I have my family with money and they help me pay everything, I'm off in 2 years. I can vote. If I can't, I can vote in 4 years. So if you're on felony probation and parole, you cannot vote in the state of Missouri. So I could perhaps spend 2 or 3 or 4 more years on supervision and not be able to vote. I should say we did these interviews right after the last election. We asked tons of people their thoughts about the election and their willingness to vote, which again, we'll have to make a paper. I mean, just fascinating. People are very civically engaged, have lots of thoughts, and a lot of people really felt like they were missing out on the election. So that's such a critical part of our democracy if we think about it. And we are just saying, because you don't have money, you're not worthy. We also know it's a potential for probation parole violation. So if you don't pay for 3 months, you do get a violation, and that triggers that lack of good time. But you can be brought in for willful non-payment. That doesn't seem to happen a lot, but it does happen. And again, it's just larger, this larger watching of people that is really the challenge. So as I mentioned, this is that earned compliance credit. So this person wanted to do it, but they didn't, right? So this is just an explanation. So this person's restitution is so high. She said, their probation parole officer was like, you have to spread it out, right? Because this person had suspended in position of sentence. So if they didn't pay, then they could be revoked to prison. So they just said, you gotta spread it out and you don't wanna earn the compliance. It's gonna be a violation. So people explain this to them. There are ways to waive your fines and fees on supervision. What I have found is just like anything, there are lots of probation and parole officers who really work with people, look to see how much they make, help them with the paperwork. It's something that has to be done at our capital in Jefferson City, but some people don't. There's new officers, they don't know. Some people feel like they should have skin in the game. They're like, it's only $30, so they don't help. Some people will wait for the person to say that they can't pay instead of bringing it up. So there's just, it's not a simple system. So I wanted to kind of wrap it up and I'll talk about policy. So again, this is a larger issue when we think about punishment, right? Who are we supposed to punish? The person that did the crime, right? Do the time, all of that stuff, an eye for an eye, all that stuff. What we find is that most of the people, not all, but a lot of the people in our sample are not paying their fines and fees. This mostly goes, like I said, and again, it's not just me because I'm a woman, but I'm very interested in gendered. This is a gendered system. Moms, girlfriends, aunts are paying, right? And so you ask them about their mom and their girlfriend or aunt, and they'll tell you, mom doesn't have any money either, but mom's scraping, she's doing an extra job, right? So when we talk about gendered poverty and gendered poverty with children, this is where we see some of this legacy. It's really, really, really subtle unless you look for it. But we see members of the community really suffering to help out these people. So are we punishing the person that did the crime, or are we punishing their family? And do we want to punish their family? What's the use of this? So here's just a quote. I was in there for a day, I had to make it $200 payment and they locked me up, and then my sister made the payment for me and I got right back out. What we also see is, you're not surprised, is people burn bridges. So maybe once or twice or three times mom will pay you, but then afterwards she will not. Okay, so just some of the conclusions, and I'll talk a little about policy. I'm interested in all of your questions. So we know that monetary penalties have a cumulative effect, right? So they add up. I think that's the biggest thing I want you to take away, is that it's not just the $60 for the parking ticket that I haven't paid. It's the failure to appear. Bench warrant charge is $150. It's the pretrial costs I have to pay. It's a loss of work. All of these, they can really affect your lifetime trajectories. And like I said, it's very sticky. I love this idea that Chris has been talking about. We also talk about, you know, desistance disruption. That's one theme that we see throughout this, is that people are doing okay, and then I have lots of narratives. I was doing great, I had a job, and then I was driving through, we'll just pick on Maplewood. They've got a big court action against them. I was driving through Maplewood, I got picked up, they ran me, they found out I have 8 failure to appears, and I'm in jail. Now I'm doing that world tour again. And so you're doing okay, and then you get, you know, sucked back in. This really affects social inequalities. We're talking about some people who are very, very, very poor. So this is really important to look at. And it can also deepen inequalities with families as well. So what's this policy, right? And like I said, this is from the prison in Jefferson City. This is an emergency in what I think. I mean, I think what we saw in Ferguson was a big cry, right? This has been going on forever. Fines and fees are just as old as prisons. But we really need to think about policy. One of the biggest things, I think, is we need to define what indigence is. I can't even say it half the time. And we don't have a way to assess indigence. I've gone to a lot of different big meetings of people from all different sorts of states. How do you figure out if someone can pay or not, right? Do you make them bring in their tax forms? Can people read tax forms? Can they fill in the paperwork? These are huge barriers. One thing Massachusetts is doing, Massachusetts does everything, is they, if you have a SNAP card, right, you're already under federal benefits, you're like, hey judge, here's my SNAP card. They're like, okay, at least then we know for sure. Like, that's one level. If you have that, it's no problem, then they automatically waive it. These are simple solutions. This is not hard. Part of the hard part is educating judges that that's okay, right? You will still get your skin if we waive some of their fees. We can also merge local data sets. We have so much big data. I don't know if any of your students here are looking at big data. Let's try, I mean, if we're gonna collect everything on everybody and use it against you, let's also use a little bit for good. Let's help the judge know how much this person pays, how much their last income taxes were. I know all this stuff is very, very difficult. But we have no accepted form in Missouri to say that someone can pay or not. Like, there's no, I don't even know how judges do it half the time. Most of the time it's the federal poverty rate, but it's very inconsistent across the board. One thing I mentioned here as well is this failure to appear. We had 10,000 people in St. Louis County who didn't appear in 1 year, 17,000 warrants. That's about $150 a pop. Okay, I hear this from judges all the time. You gotta show up for court. Okay, I love our judges. They've been fantastic with reform, but there's some of them I really want them to take the bus to the court and figure out how long it takes to get to the bus, right? Who's gonna watch your kids, all of these things. So one thing, there are very simple solutions, and I talk about text messaging, and I just gave a talk last week at a different audience, and I talked about this. This is really simple. We know that most people have a cell phone, not a perfect one, but a lot of people are able to get text messages. That increases your appearance rate by about 30 to 40%. It works the same when you forget your dentist appointment, right? All done that. So these are simple things. We can also allow people first failure. So if you miss your court date, we're like, you should not have missed your court date. Here is a reminder to go to your court, and here's a bus pass. That also increases. Most of the people who are not coming to court are not axe murderers out there in the community. That is not who we're trying to get back to court. So let's try to help people a little bit as well. I am very proud of Missouri, even though I told you all this bad stuff about Ferguson. Immediately following Ferguson, there's been so many different reforms. So we have reduced the amount of fines and fees each community can take. Granted, that the fact that we had to reduce it to just 20% of your overall earning for your city, so this is how cities are being funded. You wonder why we have 90 municipalities with just 1 million people? They were funding their whole police department by fines and fees. So we've limited the amount that you can earn from fines and fees, and also put a lot of requirements in terms of how much training your police department must have and your court must have as well. And it has worked. We've seen a lot of, I think about 10 police departments and courts go out of business. And we've also made a cap on how much you have to pay in terms of these municipal court fines and fees. One thing I was just blown away at when I drove out, I went to talk to a judge in Cape Girardeau, like I said, in the south part of Missouri, and I was like, how do you decide how much my like failure to register my boat cost is, right? How do you decide that? How much do you decide, like, the, we have a lot of problems with like dogs. A lot of people get dog tickets. How much do you decide? How do you decide that? He's like, oh, I asked Frank over there in Clark County, and this is what he charges in his county, and so I decided to charge this in my county. Like, there, I don't know. I mean, I don't know, right? There's just no training. And so trying to put some of these guidance for judges and court systems is really important, because people who are running municipalities just haven't had the same amount of training, and they're all over the state. I'm sure it's the same in Texas as well. So I don't want to talk about this too much, but I just brought this mostly for the students. I was really lucky to 2 years ago go over and teach in the Netherlands and did some research on all of this. But have you heard of the concept of day fines? Perhaps you have. They've tried them in a couple of different places in the U.S. in the late 80s and 90s. And so instead of paying, we all pay the same, it would be calibrated based on how much you make, right? So we'll look at how much you make, and we decide that I make this much and my failure to register my dog is worth 1 point, so I lose like 1 day of work. So however much that would be for me, you always use the example like Bill Gates then would pay $1,000 and I would pay 50, and then many students would pay zero. So this does work all over Europe. And I know you can't read that, so I apologize, but I can give you the link to the article. It's a fantastic researcher in Rotterdam that went through and looked at all of these different countries. I mean, Sweden's been doing it since 1931. Poland is relatively new, but it has worked in many different countries. And so I know it's difficult for us in the US. Most of my students are like, we're not in Europe. Okay, I get that a lot. I don't know if you guys get that in your classes, but you know, there are other ways to do this that have worked, so we don't need to reinvent the wheel. And it seems like this is coming back up for a policy discussion. So I want to say that this work is not my own. I can't ever take credit for this. I have the most amazing team. So I have Christina Garrity, Morgan McGurk, Dale, Dan Erebor, and Andrea Jeffrey, who have all been working on my team, just tirelessly driven all over the place. And that's a picture outside of the Jackson, Missouri courthouse. So as you can see, I go everywhere and take pictures. But that's all I have, so I thought I'd take questions.
Hello, hello. Anybody have a question?
We have a lot of time. It didn't take me as long as I thought it would, so we have lots of time.
Hello.
Hi.
I'm Ryan.
Nice to meet you.
Thanks.
Think we've ever met in person.
I was wondering if you were able to get a general sense of like how much revenue these municipalities were generating, like in a kind of a broader dollar figure sense. I'm just curious, how much money are we talking about?
That's a good question. I didn't bring that slide. I should have brought that. I know in St. Louis City last year was about $5 million. I mean, it's an astronomical amount of money. Again, when you're thinking about it's places like CNN, which I know doesn't mean anything to you, but smaller municipalities of $30,000, there's about 30 to 40% of their revenue pre-Ferguson was coming from fines and fees, tickets. Just traffic tickets, you didn't mow your lawn tickets, all of those things. Oh my gosh, yes. He asked, do I get any pushback? Absolutely. Not me necessarily. I haven't presented this as much to the group, but absolutely. I'm sure this is the same in Texas as is everywhere, right? Like, people are like, this is my city. This is my identity, right? I've grown up in St. Anne. I've grown up in Maplewood. We know our rules, right? Rules are very place-bound. We know our rules. We know our community. Of course, that comes with it. Our community is superior. You know, we need to have our own people watching our own people, our own court, be our own community court. That's why municipal courts are so fantastic and interesting, is that it's really a microcosm versus like a larger court or something like that. Absolutely, there's so much pushback by municipal courts. They have fought this tooth and nail. That's why it's fascinating. You know, we talk a lot about our research, where the reforms are really being done is people are suing. A lot of municipalities. I mean, I can't believe how warm people were to our research, given how much the feds and many different places are in there just suing people. So, yeah, like, you know, it's interesting, those spinal cord fees, a lot of those fees are probably going to go away. California has had a lot of action, class action lawsuits about those that's not, we can't actually charge for that. But yes, absolutely. And the sheriffs do not want to talk about how much they charge people a day in jail. That's because that's their bread and butter. I should say in St. Louis County, we do not charge you for staying at the jail.
Thank you. I just had a question. So you talked a little about merging local data sets. I was just wondering if there's been any steps towards making a more centralized system to track fines and monetary penalties for people?
Absolutely, that's a great question. And I can't remember what Becky has said. Becky Pettit at the University of Texas in Tooele, Texas. So I know you guys don't, because she has to like contact each of the courts. She's actually doing a study, and she's contacted every single court in the state of Texas, and she files the response. Some people will send it right away. Some people will say you have to FOIA it, stuff like that. So in terms of, I can just talk about Missouri. Missouri's struggling in terms of that. I mean, like I said, I love Missouri. We don't collect race. This is why I can't write a lot of papers on some of the data that I have from the state, because we just don't know. We don't know some of those like basic things. So we did get funding. The National Institute of Justice funded some, with Obama, some fines and fees research, and so we are, it's called, I can't remember the name of it, but it's a statewide system, so you could track it. So that's been something that they are working at, but that's gonna take us 3 or 4 years. I have to say, if any of you go work for a criminal justice data company, one of the biggest things I see is I'll go to, they're my friends, right, in Cape Girardeau. I love the judge, she's great. She's like, I would totally give you my data if I could get it out of the computer. I'm not kidding. And I've like tried to send her. I have like these students up here, like they know all of this. They can't get the data out of their computer. It's really predatory. We sell these courts, these data systems, and then we don't help them get it out. So like, what's the use of collecting data if you can't get it out? So they can't tell you. Like, they can't tell you how much you owe. So how are you supposed to know how much you owe? It's very convoluted. And we're so far behind in criminal justice data, it's not even funny. I can probably, you guys know that though. But yeah, that's where I think we need to put a lot of federal money, you know, just helping people get these data.
Yes, great talk. I just have one question. Did you have any questions on your qualitative asking about financial literacy?
About financial literacy, thank you very much. That's a great question. That's something that I didn't ask about initially, but then once I did like 5 or 10 interviews, I started asking people about. And I'm actually working with Equifax right now to put in a proposal to look at financial literacy. Yeah, people, I mean, most of us aren't as literate financially, and people definitely are not literate. It's amazing. A lot of people knew how to check their credit score thanks to those wonderful jingles on the TV. And they could check it on Facebook, right? So they knew that they had a bad credit score. A lot of people are like, oh my gosh, my score's in the toilet. I can't, you know, get any help. So, but people just, like I said, most citizens don't have an idea. Like most of us, if we had a $500 bill, could not pay it. And so, yeah, people had no financial literacy, like threw bills in the mail, in the trash, instead of like, you know, they just didn't know what to do with it. Like where to even start.
Hi. You talked about the disconnect within the jails and communication. I'm assuming this would be the same, but have you seen this disconnect with commissary? Like, if I'm in jail, I get commissary, I get transferred. Like, does my money follow me? Like, have you seen that sort of pattern?
Oh, that's a good question. It does definitely does not follow you in the state of Missouri. So, if you're in one prison, then you have, like, Department of Corrections has your commissary, then it will stay with you. So that's good. But no, if you have commissary in the jail, then you have to petition the jail to get your commissary money back, right? And so you go to the Department of Corrections. Again, I don't know how to get your commissary money back. I go to jail all the time. I have no idea how to do that. But you have to have, again, you have to have, it's usually mom or somebody who's going to write, or people in prison will ask. But there's just no way to transfer that money. At all. So that's a great question. So yeah, maybe, and this is the thing, a lot of times people don't know how long they're going to be in jail. So they think they're going to be in jail for a couple weeks or something. And some of these cases take a really long time. And so they might have sent more money. So there's just no way for the jails and prisons to communicate at all, as far as I know. It's a, that communication needs to be much, much better. Absolutely.
Thanks for the talk.
Thank you.
I grew up in Lebanon, Missouri.
Oh, great.
And in Lebanon, we think Sedalia is progressive.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I can see that.
It's a metropolis.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a metropolis, it is.
So how is the rural areas, what are they doing with reforms,
mm-hmm.
like cash bail, mm-hmm. compared to the more urban areas? Is there any movement of towards cash bail reform?
Mm-hmm. That's a great question. So yes, and that is one of the challenges. I really want to do like deep, really, really rural communities. It's just for time and staffing, like you can only, like Sedalia is where everybody comes. So yeah, you're absolutely right about Sedalia. So in terms of bail reform, absolutely there is work happening. And all of this work is not being done at this the local courts. It's being done by the Supreme Court. So starting June 30th, right now, we always, the assumption is you always have to pay, you always have a monetary bond, right, in Missouri. So that's something different. So they're asking courts to switch to the presumption that there is no bond set for most people and that you'll have to justify bond. So that's from the Supreme Court, a Supreme Court rule. The challenge is the Supreme Court has this rule. You also must be seen within 48 hours. This is a huge, huge change in Missouri. People are really, really, really worried. Like, how are we gonna do this? We're gonna have to have people on the weekends and stuff like that. The challenge is that there's all of these courts and these rules and then no one to enforce them, right? So there are two court monitors in the state of Missouri and they do go visit all of the courts, but it's just hard. And I should say, one thing that came out a lot in my interviews is that the people in the rural courts are mad at St. Louis. They're really, really mad at St. Louis. They were like, we were playing by the rules to begin with, right? I don't know what you guys are doing up in your rogue justice. You guys think we're all hick? Here, we have done all the rules, and so you guys were not playing. So they're really mad at St. Louis because now the magnifying glass is just on everybody. So, like I said, the challenge is we pass these rules and these reforms, which I think are good, but we have no training for judges, you know, no continuing education, no way to reinforce this. So what are they going to do, right? And so the state of Missouri is going to move to the pre-sentence assessment, the Arnold tool. But again, that's going to take years, so we'll see.
Thanks, Beth. Mm-hmm. This was a really interesting talk. So I have a question about interest being applied to mm-hmm. fines and fees. I know in some states with child support debt, mm-hmm. interest will accrue
Absolutely.
While someone is incarcerated, mm-hmm. and interest rates are quite high.
Mm-hmm.
So on top of these fines and fees, do you see in some of these jurisdictions interest being applied to outstanding debt?
That's a good thing that we do in Missouri. So I'm going to give Missouri kudos that we don't have interest in Missouri. But that she's like, I'm going to ask more. We'll just talk.
It's yeah, fine. I just have one more.
No, I think, yeah, that's a huge, huge issue in California and Washington. Just enormous. And actually, Washington's just done some reforms on that. We don't stay, your child support while you're in prison, though. That does not go away. And there is some, a little bit of interest on that in some ways that that is, but not your fines and fees. Those stay there, but there's no interest applied on that. But that is a huge, huge, huge problem. And that's how people really get hit in Washington and California, I'm sure other states.
And then the last question, how can these debts be squashed outside of course, paying them? So how can they officially be terminated, be off the books, if mm-hmm. you don't pay them? How long do they just remain outstanding? Can individuals opt into, say, you know what, I have more time than money and I can't mm-hmm. stand this, so I will okay. do the time and mm-hmm. then can that clear the debt? I guess I'm just, yeah. at what point does it end?
At what point does it end? It doesn't end. Good question. No, this is great. I should add this to my talk as well. So what can you do to get rid of this? So in the municipal court, so these were part of the reforms post-Ferguson, you had to offer people community service. Before, you didn't have to offer community service. It was just like whatever the judge wanted to do. And now you just have to offer them, but that's all you have to do is offer it to them. And there's no like rate or anything. So the going rate is $10 a day. So you have to be allowed to pay off your fines and fees with community service in the municipal court. So that's a requirement. The challenge is, again, it's done so differently. So if you get in trouble in Cape Girardeau, you have to work at the recycling center. I'm assuming that's not the best work. I'm not sure, I've not been there. But that's the way they do it. You get trouble in Cape, that's where they send you, that's where you have to go. Other places you can do something like at a church or maybe, you know, again, this is very gendered, disability, you know, gender, or like all of these issues, right? So what if I can't work in the recycling center? What if I'm ill? What if I have kids? The recycling centers, I'm assuming, only open during business hours. So you're technically offered. When we go to court a lot, it seems like people will be like, and so this is another challenge. If I can't pay at the municipal court, so I owe $100, and I go to the judge, I'm like, I can't pay. She'll be like, okay, but then you have to come to the payment docket, and so you have to come again in a month. So I come again in a month. So that's, again, a lot of cost there. But so if I come back and I'm like, I can't do my community service, then they'll switch it back to the fine. What people do is, it's, again, very, it's varied. So in St. Louis City, you probably know about St. Louis City. We've got more guns than we know what to do with. So if after a while you start paying $5 and you pay $5 for a while, the judge just doesn't have time. Like if we had to have everybody come every month who didn't pay, we just run out of people. So we do something like that. There are amnesty days sometimes where you can come in and just organizations will just help you and say, what can you pay? Just try to get it off your books. So there's stuff like that. But there's no statutory requirement that must go away. Absolutely, that can stay with you forever. And like I said, if you do not pay the Department of Corrections, it's like your student loans. You're never gonna, that never goes away, ever, as far as I know. They have really good records, and so they'll even send once a year, they have a big push to get those monies back. If you get a tax return, I'm sure some of you are just excited to get a tax return, they will take that money too. So we do garnish your tax return. So some people actually are great with that. They're like, great, just take me a tax return. But there's no way. Yeah, so these are like luggage. You don't get rid of it.
Hi, thank you for coming. My name is Holly. I do a lot of research with people who have sexually offended. In the beginning, you said something about kind of differential fines or fees for people who have sexually offended. What have you found in your research is different for those folks?
Great question. So yeah, I've done a couple projects, but a project before this, I did the residence restrictions in Missouri and Michigan. So I also interviewed like over 100 people with sexual crimes, convictions. Yeah, so there's a lot of things. Lie detector tests. So if you are convicted of most sexual offenses in Missouri, you're on the registry for the rest of your life. It's just changing right now, but most people are on the registry for the rest of their life. And they're also under supervision for their whole life. So you have to have a lie detector test every year. And if you fail, and we all know that those aren't perfect, if you fail, you have to take it again. And you have to pay about $150 a pop. And so that's a big, big issue. We don't ask anybody else no matter what they're convicted of, if they're lying or what they've done, right? Another big thing is Missouri Sex Offender Program. You're required to do that in prison. And then you're required to go to mandatory counseling 1 to 3 times a week. That's $25 a pop, in addition to your supervision fee. So you're going to have to pay that $30 for the rest of your life a month, and then those, you know, $100 of counseling fees as well. So those are the big ones. I'll send it to you if you're interested. I did a map of rural, you know, sexual offenders in Missouri, and so they have to go to, the cost would be to go to counseling every week, which is, again, $25 to $75 a week, and then most of them have to travel a great deal. So a lot of people, you know, there's only one treatment provider in the whole 2-county area, and so they must travel for that as well. So yeah, it's those kind of layered fees. And also the stigma that comes along with it. And I get the fear of people who have been convicted of sexual offenses. We've talked to a lot of interesting people of that part of that, but it's just that they put everybody in one group. So we've just started the tier system, but right now all of our sanctions are across the board. If you flashed at, we have the second largest Mardi Gras in the United States. I literally warn my students, if you flash at Mardi Gras, you could be on the registry and have to do these for life, versus people who have done pretty egregious things against children. So absolutely, we see a lot of things. And people don't care as much about that, but I think it's important, again, to talk about this group of people who sanction differently.
You mentioned that the debt that you get doesn't really go away. So if someone were to die or run away and just leave, what happens mm-hmm. to it? Does it go to their family, and does that contribute to the generational poverty?
Yeah, no, I never even thought about that. Thank goodness. No, it does not go to their family, but it does stick around. I mean, again, we have horrible records. However, somehow we can always figure out how to get you to pay, right? So it doesn't go to your family or anything like that. But we'll see people who will go 5-10 years. Actually, I had my students write about fines and fees last semester, and one student was like, oh, I was moving out of town. I mean, how many of you had this happen? You get a ticket, you're moving out of town, he moved to another state, and he completely forgot, not like some sort of negligent, and then came back and saw all these things had added up, right? So it does stay there, but it doesn't go to your family or anything like that, thank goodness.
Thanks, Beth. Speaking of families, since we know that a lot of crime and antisocial behavior tends to be concentrated within families, mm-hmm. does your research look beyond just the individual to see how this is impacting the family unit? You know, dads getting fines, and the son, and grandpa, and uncle, and their spouses, or are you looking at beyond just the individual impact?
Mm-hmm. We talked to, these interviews are quite long. I think we could probably do a lot more about the impact on their families. But yeah, we have people just talk about their family debt. You know, we have a lot of people who one person works to support a large family. Again, particularly in rural areas, we just have one earner, and sometimes that's the earner who has the debt, and just how that affects everybody and how everybody must work together. So they do talk a lot about their families. Again, particularly a lot of discussion of strain on their families. You know, they have gotten in trouble, how much mom or dad or sister have had to give up for that, how much it has affected their children as well. Because it's that opportunity cost, right? So I want to do this with my kids, but I can't. People talk a lot about that in child support. Like, I'm just trying to live, and I'm trying to take care of my kids who are physically here, but I also have to pay all that child support from when I was in prison. So, how am I supposed to pay for them now and pay for them, historically at the same time? So that's just a huge struggle. And parental guilt is universal. You find, right, people are just always want to do more for their kids. So they talk a lot about not being able... some of these interviews I did around the holidays, not being able to provide their kids around the holidays. So this, yeah, absolutely. But I think there's a lot more to be done in that realm.
Are you seeing a lot of concentration? So when you're doing your interviews, when you're doing your interviews, are you seeing family members? Like, you're doing these interviews with multiple people that are within the same family unit.
I'm not, unfortunately. No, that would have been great. I think that's where we really need to go, I think, in this sort of research, is that, in some ways it's, you know, just to be completely honest, it's easy. You know, you go to the probation parole office, I'm just like hanging out and being like, hey, you can talk to me for 20 bucks. Or I go to the library and hang out, hey, you can talk to me for 20 bucks. And so people aren't always with their families. I think it's a lot harder. In human subjects, it's also a lot harder as well. But I think that's really where we need to go to kind of get this generational impact. I always like Catherine Eden's work, and I really want to, sorry, to my wonderful partner over here. I really want to move to like rural Illinois or Missouri and really just hang out with people and their families and talk about their debt and how the system affects them, but I haven't done that yet. So, yeah.
Hi, thank you. Thank you again for the talk. It was really, really interesting. I'm wondering if your research, have you looked into the treatment of juveniles and how fines may be applied to juveniles versus adults, or
yeah, great
who
question.
Normally gets...
No, that's a great question. I don't do a lot of this work. Karen Martin, who's now at the University of Washington, she was in New York. She's just the best person ever, and she does amazing work on juvenile fines and fees. This is where we've seen a lot of reform. Technically, right now, we can fine parents if the child has been in the juvenile system. Missouri has the Missouri model of juvenile corrections, and so we've moved away from a lot of those fines and fees, so it's not as big of an issue that we see in Missouri, but California has done a huge amount of reform on that area, and that's where I think some of these reforms are starting out and making a lot of toeholds, because people are like, well, we don't want to fine parents for their kids' behavior. Kids aren't seen as culpable, you know, or they don't have those, like, Kohler Houseman desires to behave in a certain way, so that's where I see a lot of the reforms. But there are definitely some states will fine a lot for juvenile courts as well, so it's a huge problem.
Hi, so I'm wondering, when you're interviewing the stakeholders, mm-hmm. if in any of the smaller communities, or any of the communities really, if they're seeing some of the reforms as helpful in reflection, as kind of
right.
bringing the communities out.
Right. Well, and this reminds me of something, I should write this stuff down, but Melinda asked, yes and no, do they think that they helped? Again, some of these rural communities are like, they're like, come on, you guys, like, knock it off. What are you doing in St. Louis? You guys think you're like all cool and just stop it. What you can't do anymore is, we used to be able to allow people to spend the weekend in jail if they couldn't pay their fine. So that's probably what you're getting to. So I apologize for missing that. So we used to allow people, they'd be like, just do the weekend and then you're done. You can no longer jail people on municipal offenses, which is great, right? We don't want people in jail. But a lot of people will tell me, like, oh, last time I just did a weekend in jail. It's like, whatever. I don't work on the weekends. Or I don't work on Tuesdays and Wednesdays. So I just did the jail time. I can do that standing on my head. It's not a big deal. And judges will say, particularly people who don't have the money, would prefer to do the weekend in jail. So they don't like that. Judges do not like to be watched. Not surprisingly, that's because you become a judge. So there is a lot of pushback. I think I have seen, just in the time that I've been in Missouri, I mean, I can't tell you enough about how much Ferguson kind of affected all of us, I think, to the core. And I think people just never thought about it, right? Like, people come into your court and you make them pay a fine and you just don't think about it. And so I think people are forced. There's no way in Missouri you are not forced to think about this. Although, actually, I should say in Sedalia, people are like, what was Ferguson? So there is, but at least where my region is. But people don't know how to do it, right? And people really, I work with so many smart people, and I'm like, so like our drug court, it's a big problem. Drug court and DUI court, when you sign up for it, and so this is, you know, you get your conviction taken away. Like, they're not going to convict you if you complete the drug court. But as you're part of your paperwork, they're like, you'll have to pay $3,000. And people are like, I can't pay $3,000, right? And so I... telling judges, like, they can't pay $3,000. Well, you know, Beth, we spread it over 3 years. And I was like, no. But you show them the $3,000 the minute they sign up. And so it's this education, like, people don't have money. Like, it's not like you're short on cash and you're in college and had to eat a lot of ramen. Like, people, like, are destitute, impoverished. It's really hard to put yourself in those shoes. And I'm serious in that I think we need to bring judges, and it's not just judges, prosecutors, criminal justice actors, I think citizens. I think we should make everybody tour some jails, don't you think? I know our jail director tries to bring community groups as much as he can. My awesome colleague, former who passed, Bob Bursick, used to make all of our students ride the bus. That was his assignment. He would make them ride the bus for a couple of hours and try to get different places. I know it sounds silly, but I think some of those things like this empathy, understanding the lives of citizens is really important. It's really hard to know, particularly when you're hardened. I even sometimes, like after I interviewed all those hundreds of people convicted of sexual offenses, I got a little hard, right? I think it's hard when you see people who do, some people come to court and do some pretty heinous things. So it's hard.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Huebner.
Thank you. Oh.